Or if you want, I can give an introduction to myself. You know, I can like be like Voldemort, give myself a Horcrux and split myself into two parts, and one of those could give an introduction to the other, but let's not go into all of that. What I'll instead do is I'm going to discuss about a very, very interesting algorithm. It's extremely interesting in its own right, but I should say a couple of caveats, you know, a disclaimer rather, I should say. As you might have probably observed, not just in all the talks that happened, but you know, from the past 2 days, you surely have observed that many of the speakers here explain concepts. The philosophy of ISA is this, you know, so they don't explain concepts to you in a manner that you know, we don't believe in the philosophy of spoon feeding. Why? Because we are Indians, you know, we believe you should eat with hands. So, the point here is that most of the speakers here will give you only the bare minimum essential required to spark off your curiosity and interest and go ahead and read up the things on your own. You would have seen that in almost all the talks. Then just in each and every point, we sort of expected you to make a note of things that interest you and go back and read the paper and all of that. So you know, even my talk would be something of that sort. You know, I should say that I'll not be explaining everything for, because the reason is, actually you saw the time, right? It's pretty early for me to be starting my talk, and thanks to Snigdha's generosity, who decided to end the talk early for a reason, because I told her in advance that, you know, I'm a sort of speaker who, if you give me a mic, well, I don't need a mic. Actually, my voice is loud enough, but you know, we have a problem. The cameras that we have over here are cameras can only record from the mic. Even if I just speak, you know, without the mic, the camera will not be, the audio will not go to the camera. And you know, I just wonder why. If we can make cameras see, why can't we make them hear? So that's on camera technology. So what I was trying to say was that so Snigdha told she'll leave early because my talk is the point is, if you give me a mic, if you don't give me a mic also, if I just stand on the stair and if I start speaking, I suffer from the halting problem. And you know, I might not even end by 11 o'clock where I started at 10. Even now I might not end, because what I'm trying to say is my talk is going to be really, really technically deep. So deep, and I can guarantee that half of you by the end of this would have turned into zombies. And the rest half of you might even have started digging your own graves, you know. But a word of advice, my dear friends. Please don't start digging your own graves now, because if you do, you'll fall down in the ground floor. So, okay, let's begin. I like Dilbert a lot. Just to reinforce what I was trying to say, that, you know, we sort of expect that you figure out things on your own, although this is in no way trying to deter you from asking questions over the course of the talk. However, I will forbid you from asking one type of question over my talk, okay? I do not wish to hear you ask the question as to, why the hell am I doing something like this? What is the meaning of all this? How it looks like magic. How is it working? I forbid you from asking this question. Because for two reasons. Firstly, if you do ask the question, I will go temporarily deaf, okay? And secondly, if you actually do ask the question, and if I do try to answer the question, the summer school will continue to become a spring school and a monsoon school and whatever. It will go on forever. I do not want to go into the details. It's a really beautiful, intricate algorithm, which I will not explain the proof of working. Take it almost as if it's a sorcery or witchcraft or something. It's going to work, and it's going to work in such a way that you'll be awed by the beauty of the algorithm, okay? So, no motivation for the talk. Oh, by the way, that reminds me. Let me sort of inspire and motivate you. I saw a very, very inspiring scene, you know? So, I was coming this morning, and then I just noticed in the bus stop, there was this really fat lady who was waiting for a bus. She asked me, like, which bus goes to Majestic? And then I told her the bus is supposed to Majestic, and it just went off. She was just waiting over there. Isn't it inspiring? It's such a motivating scene. Get it? Okay, bad joke. So let's proceed. I'm going to give you perhaps only a minute or two to construct a DFA for this. And if the sentence just goes over your head, the rest of the talk will go over the window itself. try to see if you can construct the DFA. I'm sure all of you have done a course in automata theory, which unfortunately is a course which most people only remember the name of the course by the end of it. They won't remember anything that happened in the course, because of which I asked you to revise yesterday. So can someone tell me how you would construct a DFA for this? I'm not going to go into the definition of a DFA because I'm assuming you know it. Anyone got the DFA already? So can you tell me how many states would it have? Let me make it a little more clear. You know, with the question standing the way it is, you can give me any answer and I can say yes. Because you can be stupid to make a DFA of 10 states, which is equivalent to the right one. So I'll rephrase my question. Can you construct a minimal DFA that accepts this language? It should have 4 states. So can you tell me how the 4 states should look like? We should have a start state by the definition of DFA. What should the transitions be? Alphabet here we saw is A comma B, right? So what should happen here on the state A? It loops on the same state? No, it goes to a new state, right? So if I get an A, I go to some new state. Okay, what happens here if I get a B? Go to the same state? Another new state. Why should I do that? That's a very sort of narrow-minded definition. I mean, you know, it's one nice thing about this DFA kind of things, you know, if somebody asks you a question, why do you need a new state? You can just make very, very glazing kind of statement saying that, you know, without this extra state, you'll not be able to remember and all of that. But that's like kind of sweeping it under the carpet. To be precise, you need something known as equivalence classes and Mihalnyi-Narod theorem, which I'll not go into all of that. But we need a new state because we want to remember the fact that we have got a B. And remembering that we have got a B is not the same as a machine remembering that it got an A. You remember what? Why do we have states in the DFA? Because the DFA is a dumb finite automaton. DFA. No, it's a deterministic finite automaton. But the reason is because the DFA has no memory. The only memory that a DFA has is in the form of states. It has no long tape, no working memory, no RAM, no hard disk, nothing. It just has states as a form of memory. And therefore, the only way I can remember stuff is by making transition to a new state. Because of which, if I see an A, I should remember that I got an A, so I go to a new state. And I should go to a new state for B as well, because the state is supposed to imply that I've seen a B so far, not I've seen an A. Okay, so I think I'll skip off the rest of the explanations, but can you complete this for me? Where should this one go on an A? New state?
No, previous state.
Previous state, very good. What should this do on a B?
New state.
New state or this one?
New state.
Okay, new state. Good. So we see we have got 4 states. What about this state on a A?
This state of A, that previous B.
Then A. This one or this one? The first one. Okay. Why is this wrong? Very good. So it should go to this state, right? On an A. Okay, let me go here on an A. What happens here if I get a B? You see, it's somewhat symmetric in the sense that, you know, if I get a B from this state, I come here. From here, if I get a B, I go back here. So what happens here if I see an A? I should be going to this state. If I see a B, I should be coming back to this state. Well, okay, let's take a moment's pause and try to ask ourselves the question, how difficult was it to construct this DFA? How much time did it take you to construct this DFA? Well, if you have probably seen the DFA before and, you know, just refresh your memory this morning, it would have been a pretty easy task and you would have told, yeah, big deal, I can do it in a second or two, I can do it in a jiffy. But suppose I gave you an arbitrary DFA problem and I asked you to come up with a DFA for it. Well, let's forget the word suppose. You actually did something of that sort during your course, right? Maybe in your exams, they gave you a problem and they asked you to construct the DFA for that, right? How did you go about doing it? Can someone give me the method by which you constructed the DFA for any arbitrary random problem? What was the algorithm you followed? Okay. Okay, so you followed the divide and conquer technique. Okay. Any other thoughts? Did everybody use divide and conquer strategy? Did someone come up with a clever way of solving a DFA problem? Any arbitrary random DFA problem? Yeah. Okay. That's a very good approach, actually. That actually works most of the time. So that's at least my technique that I follow, that I generally first try to construct a DFA for accepting the minimal length string, and then try to extrapolate from that DFA and try to add more stairs. But notice one very, very interesting thing. In all these things that we have been saying right now, we have been doing only a lot of hand waving. Okay, in my case, literally, I'm hand waving. But the point is, we just don't have a method or an algorithm to construct a DFA. I give you a problem, a DFA construction problem. The only way by which you could construct the DFA is hand waving. It's just, you know, just use creativity, imagination, brains, all of that stuff. Can I give you a guarantee, a procedure, a method, an algorithm, which if you mechanically followed, or if you gave it to a first standard student to mechanically follow for a DFA problem, so that he will be able to get the correct DFA, minimal DFA, exactly. Wouldn't it be so awesome if we had such an algorithm? That's the Angling's algorithm. Angling's algorithm is an algorithm where I only give you the problem statement. Well, few caveats. I mentioned about that. You also have a little few other things. But in general, it's, you just give the problem and you just run through the algorithm, and the output of the algorithm is your DFA. So it's such a very powerful algorithm that if you had known this when you were in your second year, when you learned automata theory, you could have followed this in your exam and got the right DFA correctly. It would not have been a matter of cleverness, creativity, guessing, intuition, and all of that. You should not believe in gut feelings, because the gut has no feelings except hunger. So let's proceed. That's it. That's all, folks. So, you know, I'm a prankster. I was just trying to see the reaction on your face. This is not the end. It's just the beginning. So, the Angular's algorithm is what's known as an L star algorithm. It was devised by this person called Dana Angluin. So, she called it as L star. The star there is for what? Because it's magic. Star. Condition supply and all that. No, star stands for regular languages. So, she also came up with another subsequent algorithm that learns a context-free language automatically, which I'm not going into right now. I'm only going to discuss about the algorithm which learns a DFA. So what this algorithm does is, it's clever in the sense that it's a machine learning algorithm. It's a very strange algorithm because it's a kind of machine learning. You already had an introduction to machine learning, and I'm not going to go into all of that which you already learned in machine learning, because this is a very different sort of a machine learning algorithm. It really learns. This is a procedure whereby, you know, a learner can learn a DFA. Learner, like in this case, you can think of you people as the learners, and there's a teacher. So there's a notion of a teacher and a learner in this DFA. So that's the caveat that I was mentioning about, you know. The caveat is, you couldn't exactly follow this algorithm in your exam if I gave you a question to solve, because you need a teacher and a learner. It's a two-party algorithm. It would be a very stupid exam if you followed this algorithm and you got up in the middle of the exam and you asked the teacher to assist you to write your paper. So this algorithm would not have helped you in your exam. But with perhaps a little bit of intelligence, you might have made it work there, which I'll tell at the end. So it's a two-party algorithm. That's an important point to remember. This algorithm requires two parties. You cannot run the algorithm on your own and get the answer. You need two parties. One party is known as the teacher, and another party is the learner. So the learner is someone who is hoping to learn the correct DFA, which he does not know the answer for. And the teacher is called a teacher for a reason, because the teacher knows the correct answer. So all through this talk, I'll be using this particular example. The example of even S and oh, we made a mistake. How could anyone not correct me? This is not a complete DFA because there's no final state. So which should be the final state? The first state. Very good. So I'm sorry, I mistook that. I completely forgot. So I'm going to refer to this DFA for the rest of the talk. I'm going to run this algorithm over this DFA and show you how it works. So as I was telling, the teacher knows the answer for the DFA. So suppose I give you this problem, even A's and even B's. The teacher already has in mind this DFA. The learner is trying to learn this DFA. And that's the algorithm, basically. You have a learner, you have a teacher. And the teacher is also sometimes known as an oracle, you know. Have you heard what you mean by an oracle? Not the company. Well, the company is also an oracle, but what's the original meaning of oracle? Sorry? A teacher? Yes, yeah, sort of. It's like oracle is something like a crystal ball kind of thing, where you ask it any question, it knows everything. It's like omniscient, you know. So you ask it any question, it knows the answer to everything. So Angluin in her paper has called that as an oracle, although it's a small misnomer, because it does not know everything. If you ask it how many legs does my dog have, it will not know the answer to that. Incidentally, I don't have a dog, but so is an oracle in the sense that it knows everything about the domain. It knows everything about the given DFA. So oracle knows everything. Oracle is the teacher. The teacher is basically the oracle. Teacher knows everything. The learner is trying to seek the help of the teacher to learn the DFA that the teacher has in mind. Okay, but there's an issue here. It would be very stupid. Actually, it's a pretty dumb algorithm. If I told you that, you know, I have a teacher, I have a learner, how will you learn the DFA? What should the learner do to learn the DFA? The most easiest thing that the learner can do to learn the DFA is to ask the teacher, my dear teacher, please give me the answer. That's it. Over. End of story. That's a stupid algorithm. You don't want that. So that's a totally uninteresting algorithm. I told you, right? Oracle knows everything. Oracle knows the whole world. It knows the answer for this DFA. And if the learner's only sole objective ambition in life is to learn the answer for this DFA, the learner can only ask the teacher the question, give me the DFA, and he can learn it. So that's uninteresting. Therefore, we make it a little more interesting by restricting our oracle, the teacher, to answer only two types of questions. Which means you as a learner cannot ask me any question. You cannot say, draw this DFA on the board. I will not draw it for you. You can only ask two types of questions. You can ask membership queries or you can ask equivalence queries. What can you make a guess what you mean by each of these? What's a membership query? Yeah? Okay. Near the mark. So what a membership query does is, the learner asks a membership query to the teacher. What I mean by that is, the learner asks a question, the learner has some string, the learner takes a string and he asks the teacher, tell me, does this string get accepted by this DFA? Is this string a member of the language? That's the membership query. So what can the teacher answer for such a question? Very good. The teacher cannot say the clouds are gray. So the teacher can only answer yes or no for a membership query. The membership query input is a string given by the learner to the teacher. The output is given by the teacher to the learner as a yes or no, depending on whether the string is accepted or not. So for example, if I ask you a membership query, is AAB a member of this language? What will be your answer? No, you'll say no, right? So because AAB does not have even number of A's and even number of B's, so you'll say no. So this is one valid query that we permit the learner to ask the teacher. The other kind of query we permit is an equivalence query. What could that possibly be? Equivalence query. No ideas? Yeah? Very good. Very, very good. So, you know, there's no point if you learn everything and you don't even know whether what you learned is correct or not. So at the end of the learning process, the learner asks the teacher whether, whatever I learned is correct or not. The learner asks, is this the right DFA? Yes or no? So again, for this equivalence query, also the teacher will answer yes or no. Okay. So what's interesting to note over here is that the learner can only pose these two types of questions. So if you want to sort of like play it like a two-party game here, you are learners and the teacher. Let's imagine you haven't seen the board. Let's imagine that maybe not imagine. My handwriting is a little kind of light, so you might not be able to actually read what I've written here. So if you were to ask if I were to ask you to construct the DFA for this language, you can actually run this algorithm. You be the learners, I be the teacher, and we can proceed in this manner, and you will see that you'll end up with the same DFA. However, as I told, the only questions you're permitted to ask me are this membership queries and equivalence queries. You can only ask me if a string belongs to the language, yes or no. Or you can ask me, I've constructed a DFA. Is it right or not? That's all you can ask me. And what's really interesting is, using only these two types of queries, membership queries and equivalence queries, you can learn absolutely any DFA in the world. Therefore, in that sense, you say that this teacher is a minimally adequate teacher. The teacher will only impart to you just the bare minimum information required for you to learn the concept on your own. So that's why you call it as a minimally adequate teacher. And in case you didn't know, I am a cartoonist. If you have seen me on Facebook, my Facebook posts are a lot of comics, so you can follow me there. But yeah, this is one of my comics. You don't have to understand each of the technical terms. Perhaps Harith might have talked about a few of them in his talk. So this algorithm requires that the teacher only answers the bare minimum. You go to a teacher, you ask him doubts, the teacher will not answer your doubts. You go to a teacher, ask him anything, he'll not answer it. He'll only answer the bare minimum required for you to put your efforts on your own and learn the concept on your own. Okay, so that's a minimally adequate teacher. Any questions? Okay. So now let's get down to brass tacks and actually understand the algorithm. As I told, it's going to be a little dense and little heavy, but I will try to explain to the best of my extent. And as I told, do not ask me the question like, how is it working? There is a proof. There is a long technical proof which I refer you to. You can go and refer to the paper. But it's not worthwhile explaining that over a lecture over here. Just take it like a sort of a black box algorithm. So the notation that we use over here is that the language that we want to learn, I'll call as U, and A is the alphabet. In this case, U is language of even A's and even B's. Alphabet here is A, which is, what is that in this case, for this problem? AB. Okay, very good. So you're away. So for this algorithm to run, we require to construct what's known as an observation table. So this algorithm, the learner learns the DFA by constructing an observation table. So learner makes some observations and constructs a table. And as a result of the table, you somehow do some surgery on it and you get the DFA. So the table that you construct is known as observation table, which consists of three parts basically. This table has three sets, S, E, T. S is, I want you to spend perhaps a few seconds and read the three of them and see if you can make some sense out of it. What do you mean by a prefix closed set? Yeah? What's a prefix closed set? What does the word closed mean? Closed again is an ambiguous term, so closed has many meanings, but prefix closed means, have you heard of the word closure in maths? If you have done a course on automata theory, you definitely would have heard the word closure, otherwise you have not done a course on automata theory. So closure is where, if you have a set, you remember what are we trying to learn? A language. What is a language? How do you define a language? A set of strings. If your automata theory teacher told you that a language is something you use for communication, go back and slap him. So that's not what you mean by language in this subject. In this subject, a language is just a set of strings. That's all, no more and no less. So we see here we have a language, which is a set. So when you have a set and you perform an operation on that set, if you get some result of doing that operation and the result of that operation is also a member of the same set, then you say that that set is closed under that operation. Agree? So what operation are we doing over here? So do you understand did you understand what I told just now? What do you mean by closure? You have a set, you perform an operation on that set, you get back some result, and if that result that you have got is also a member of the set, then you say that that set is closed under that operation. So what are the two requirements? You first of all need a set. Secondly, you need an operation. So here the set that we have here is called S, which I have not yet told what exactly it is. I'll tell you eventually. What is the operation that we have over here? What is the operation you are doing to this set? Prefix. Very good. You are trying to take prefix operation. So if I give you a set like A, B, C, D, E, and then I take prefix of this string A, B, C, D, E, what are all the possible prefixes? A is a prefix. A, B is a prefix. A, B, C is a prefix. All of those are prefixes. I'm saying that this set is prefix closed, which means if this set has A, B, C, D, E, this set should also have A in it. This set should also have AB in it. It should have ABC in it, and so on. So this is, S is called as a prefix closed, E is analogously suffix closed, and T is like our membership query kind of thing. Membership query is what you ask the teacher. The teacher will give back some answer when you ask a membership query. Remember what's a membership query? I'm just trying to check if you're awake. You ask the teacher if a string belongs to the language. Teacher will say yes or no. You make a note of that in this table for the corresponding value of T. So if the teacher says T of AB, which means if teacher says AB is accepted, then you say T of AB is equal to 1. If the teacher says that AB is rejected, then you say T of AB is equal to 0. So this T is a mapping from a set of strings to a Boolean value 0, 1. So if you ask the oracle, you ask the teacher a membership query, the teacher will give back an answer for the membership query. You as a learner go to your table and write that for T of that particular string is equal to 0, 1. So if this is the same thing. Yeah. If it belongs to the language, then T of that string will be U. Okay. Any questions on this so far? Any doubts? If you have no doubts, if you have no questions, then let's perhaps ask questions to you. Is the first one prefix closed?
No.
Why not?
Zero is not there.
Zero is not there. So what? Zero is not there, so it's not prefix closed. One moment. Someone said that zero is not there. That's not the reason why it's prefix closed. What did it tell you? The definition of prefix closed. You know, try to think of it as if you're standing on the left hand and you're seeing the string all the way here. Every prefix of every string in this set should be a member of this set. Look at the first string, 1110. What are all the prefixes of 1110? One is a prefix. Is one in the set? Yes. 1-1 is a prefix. Is 1-1 in the set? It's not. So you can do it similarly. Also, incidentally, the null string is also a prefix of a string. So we see that's also not there. So the first one is not prefix closed. What about the second one? Why not? Sorry? One is not there. Should one be there? Why? Because of this one. I keep forgetting. I have a pointer in my hand. So I keep thinking it's a dangling pointer, so I don't use it. So okay, so you see here that this a 1-1 here. What are the prefixes of this? One is a prefix. So one we see here is not available in the set. Therefore, the set is not prefix closed. How about this one? Is this prefix closed? Why not? Zero? Zero is here. 1-0 is. Why should 1-0? If you're telling the answer as 1-0, you are looking at the suffixes, not the prefixes. Prefixes means you look only from the left end. Take every possible string as a substring of a given string, starting from the left end. As the most technical definition I can give you, I wish I'd like to avoid. But is this prefix closed? Why? 1 is a prefix, it's present. 1-1 is a prefix, it's present. 1-1-0 is a prefix, that's present by itself. Lambda is a prefix, lambda is also there. That's it. So this is prefix closed. What about this one? Why is this not prefix closed? 0 is there, fine. Lambda is there. 1-0, what are the prefixes of 1-0? 1 is a possible prefix, which we don't have in this set. So therefore, this set is not prefix closed because it does not have the 1. I hope you have got the idea of prefix closedness. Okay? If you have got the idea, I'll leave you to do this very quickly because I don't have the time. Actually, I have all the time. It's you people who don't have the time. So, prefix closed. Now, when you're looking at suffix closed sets, you need to look from the right end. So, 0 is not there, right? So this is not suffix closed because you expected 0 also to be there. Is this suffix closed? Why not? 1-1 should have been a suffix, but it's there. Oh, 1-1 is a suffix. That's not present here. Very good. What about this? Why not? 1-0 is a suffix, which is not present in this set. Good. What about this? It is suffix closed. Very good. So we have understood the concept. Any questions on this? No doubts? Okay, then. Another one of my comics. You know, I'm a cartoonist by the way, okay? So, yeah. Okay, if string is ABCA, then A is a prefix, AB is a prefix, ABC is also a prefix, and the empty string is also a prefix. So that's a good point you reminded me. When I have a string X, the string X by itself is also a prefix. Like you have this notion of subset, right? If you say that you have a set, the set itself is a subset of itself. So that it's not a proper prefix in that case. Okay, so if you're done with this, let's proceed. So now I've only given you the definition of all the elements of the table, SET. I've not told you anything about how to construct a table. So remember where we are, let's look at the big picture. We're trying to learn automatically a DFA, which the teacher has in mind. And we are the learners who want to learn the DFA from the teacher. And we are trying to learn in the process by constructing a table known as an observation table. And if you want to have an observation table, if you want to have any table for that matter, any table should have at least rows and columns or legs. Okay, back one. So if this is a table, what should be the rows and columns of the table? So we see here that this says that the rows of the table should be elements of S union S dot A. Now, this is where it looks a little complicated. What do you mean? What is S? What had we seen S was? S was a non-empty set, which was prefix closed. Okay, fine. So, we have an S. And also, we have, what is A? A is the alphabet. So, let's construct our table. The rows of the table, this is my table, okay? So, it has lots of rows. the rows of this table are all elements of S as well as S dot A. So I'll write this union as a, you know, I'll split this table into two parts. One part, which the top part of the table only handles the S, the bottom half of the table takes care of S dot A. So you see here the rows of this table consists of S union S dot A, which means this table has two parts as I was telling you. The top part of the table, maybe let's say some part over here is S, and then there's some bottom part which is S dot A. All of this put together, S union S dot A, all of this put together form the rows of the table. Okay, the columns of the table are A. A is what? Our suffix closed finite set of strings. Okay, so this is our table. Initially we start off, the algorithm starts off by assigning some value for S and A. We assume initially that S is equal to the empty set. We assume that A is equal to empty set. So how will my initial table look like? Don't fill up the entries, but at least can you tell me how many rows it has and how many columns it has? Assuming this language, even number of A's and even number of B's. Can you tell me, can you construct the initial table without filling up the entries? How many rows and how many columns does it have? I've given you all the information. I'm a minimally adequate teacher. S and E are given to be lambda. And I've told you that rows should look like this, columns should look like this. So how many rows does it have initially? How many columns does it have initially? Three rows. How do you construct the table? Let's go back to this. What should be the rows? What is S initially? Lambda. So let's make the table actually. S is lambda. That's one of the rows. Is that the only row? Yeah, because we told initially S is lambda. So let's actually draw a thick line. In Angeline's paper, she has drawn a thick line to divide the top part and the bottom part of the table. I'll follow the same. So this is the top part of the table, which is lambda S. The bottom part should be S dot A. What is A here? Alphabet here is A comma B. What do you mean by dot? S dot A. The dot operation here, concatenation. So what is S is lambda? Alphabet A is A comma B. So what will you get as elements of S dot A? A and B. Very good. So you have one row for A, one row for B. What are the columns of the table? Columns will be the elements of E. And it will be initialized by starting with E as lambda. So this is my initial table with nothing filled up. Okay, this part is not there. Fine. So this is my initial table. There's a lambda which acts as the top part of the table. There's a bottom part which consists of A and B. Question so far. Any doubts? I will ignore your question if you say, why are we doing this? Hopefully by the end of this talk, you will get an intuition as to why we are doing it. I will not provide a proof though. If you have any other questions, fine. Last thing I forgot to tell. What's the row of S? Row of S here tells what is the corresponding row. So for example, let's imagine that we have, is this visible at the back, what I'm writing on the table? Did I say table? I meant screen. Okay. So imagine that I have a table where, let's call this lambda and assume that you have some number of rows. So zero. There's something over here. It should be suffix close, so I'll say this. Okay, fine. So if I say what is row of lambda, I'm just giving you a definition of the last one. Row of S. S here corresponds to each of these elements. So S is, you know, each of the rows. So row of lambda here will be the row corresponding to this particular string. So row of lambda here will be 001. You write that as some sort of a tuple, okay? So row of lambda is 001. In this case, you have seen that the table is not filled up, so I cannot ask you what is row of lambda, because right now you'll get a segmentation fault if I ask you that question. What is row of A? You don't know. What is row of B? You have not filled up the table yet. Once you have filled up the table, you can answer that question. Okay, so that's notations. So, okay, I filled up this table for you. Can you tell me what is row of lambda? What is row of A? Row of lambda? 1. What is row of A? 0. How do you determine what is that? So algorithm is pretty simple. If I ask you what is row of lambda, go to the table to that particular row which says lambda and look at the corresponding row. In this case, there's only one column. So the tuple has just one element and you say 1. Row of A is 0. Clear? So far, any questions, any confusions? Okay, good. So now comes really, really important point. It's so important that you can forget your name. As long as you don't forget this. This is more important than your name. Okay, so two very, very crucial properties. You know, this whole algorithm for the rest of this will depend on this. I had this streak of benevolence, you know, where I thought that it would be very, very unfair of me if I were to write the actual way it was written in the paper. So I translated it to a slightly more human readable format. You can see it in the paper, they use arbitrary long complicated formulas like symbols and there exists for all and all of that, but I made it at least palatable for you, you know. even though I'm sure you would have understood the other way also, but can you read this two definitions? Can you tell me what you understand out of it? What do you mean if I say that a table is closed? Spend a minute on this and tell me what you understand out of it. If I ask you to check if a table is closed, what does that mean? Yeah, you had an answer. Identical rows, not quite. Spend some time, read the definition. Yeah. Okay. Okay, that's really correct. So let me sort of like give an analogy for this. You know, you can sort of think of this in a very rough, crude way, as if I told you, right, the table has two parts. There's a top part of the table, there's a bottom part of the table. Top part is S, the bottom part is S dot A. In a very rough, crude way, you can think of it like as if in a machine learning algorithm, you have a training set and a test set, right? I think Harith would have told you about that. So you can think of it as if the top part of the table is your training data, the bottom part of the table is your test data. And let me give an analogy here. When do you say that a question paper is closed? If your teacher gave you a question paper in the exam, and she asked some question, and if you were to say that this question paper was an open-ended paper, what does that mean? That means that the teacher asked a question in the exam which she did not cover in class. So that's what it means. If you have a table which is not closed, it means that this is my test set. This is something I'm asking in the exam. It means that there was at least one question asked here in the exam which was not present in my class, the training data. So that is what I mean by closed. If a table is closed, what it means is all the rows that come over here should have already appeared at least once in the training data, should have appeared in the top part of the table. You cannot get any new elements in the bottom part of the table. Every row of S for the bottom part of the table must have appeared at least once in the top part of the table for it to be closed. Now look at this definition and see if that makes sense. Can you read that now? It says here that if it is closed, if for all elements T belonging to S dot A, the bottom part of the table, for every T belonging here, there exists some S belonging to the top part such that these two rows are equal, which means no matter what question you give me in S dot A in the final exam, there should have been some class in the semester which is S, for which, you know, the row of T should have appeared already in row of S. That is closed. Now, can you make a similar attempt for consistent and be consistent about your answer? What do you mean when you say that the table is consistent? Can you try reading this? For those of you who are more interested in mathematical symbols, you can go and read the paper. I do not want to mentally mutilate you. Yeah. I think you're right, but let me again use my analogy of the classroom. As I told, we'll assume crudely, although Anglu never says in her paper that this is the training set or test set. I've just made this analogy on my own, so you can assume this as the training set and this as the test set. What this says is that, you know, observation table is consistent if, you know, this is the training set, right? Which means whatever you teach in class. Imagine that you have a situation in class where teacher comes to the class and the teacher, like me, suffers from Alzheimer's. No, I don't, but let's imagine the teacher has a very bad memory, and on two separate classes, teacher teaches the same concept, okay? Teacher forgot that whatever she taught yesterday was the same thing I'm teaching today, and she just goes ahead and repeats herself. Let's imagine that. So let's imagine that for two classes, she repeats the same thing. Then, if the teacher goes and asks a question on the topic which she has repeated in the final exam, it would be horrible if the students were to write two different answers, because the students might have thought that on class one she taught one concept and on the second class she taught another concept. Did you get what I'm trying to say? Okay, maybe I should repeat that. So the analogy is like this. The teacher comes to a class, teaches one concept, and maybe, you know, like flushes her memory or something, and next day she comes and teaches the same concept. And then she goes ahead and asks a question on this concept in the final exam. If it so happens that the students can come up with two different answers for a question, let's imagine for sake of simplicity, that question paper is simple, no twisters and all of that. Let's imagine the teacher asks a question on the exam and the students can come up with two different answers for the same concept. And the reason why the students got confused to write two different answers was because the teacher told two contradictory things in the two consecutive classes. Then it means the teacher was inconsistent, right? What she taught on day one was not what she taught on day two. It's inconsistent. So that's the analogy. What this means basically in coming back to our tables is if you have two rows in the top part of the table, which are identical to each other, then when you go to the bottom part of the table, any concept that you can learn from this, S1.A and S2.A, it should be identical. Whatever you have learned out of these two rows, you will have to end up deriving the same thing on the bottom part of the table. Now, in terms of DFA, what exactly it means, let's try to get back to the DFA context. That all this row of S that you see over here correspond to the states of the DFA. Okay, every one of this row of S is a unique state in the DFA. So what we want is, if you say that the DFA is closed, try to think of this as if it's a DFA, okay? Imagine that this is a DFA. These are, every row that you see here is a state. Every one of the rows that you see here is a state. Why am I dividing this into two parts, the table into two parts? I'll not answer that immediately. I hope you will be able to make out when I explain. But basically, this is just for sake of our convenience. You do not need to have two parts of the table. This is only to make the algorithm a little more efficient that you divide this into two parts, okay? But so it so happens that you have all these rows, all the states in the DFA. When I say that this table is closed, it means that I am not allowed to get some new state which I have not already seen before. This S.A basically is some state which can only repeat from S. Row of S corresponds to the state of the DFA, okay? And the transitions will be between states, right? So what does it mean to say that a DFA is consistent or table is consistent? If the table is consistent, what can you imply or infer out of it? If the table is consistent, it means that whenever these two states of the DFA, when got some alphabet, went to some state, let's imagine that, I'm sorry, I think my board is getting very messy. My handwriting is terrible. Please excuse me for that. Okay, so I have a lot of examples to show that, but I just want to drive home the point first. So let's imagine that you have a table where you, this is the top part. You have two rows. Let's say there's row A and row B. There are two rows in the table. Okay, let's not make B confuse you. Let's say A itself. Two rows are identical to each other in the top part of the table. Okay. Now, as I told, imagine that these two are states. That's what the algorithm does. It essentially translates in such a way that the rows become the states of the DFA. So you can imagine that there is a transition from A on some input alphabet, right? That's what a DFA does. From a state, given an alphabet, it goes to some other state. So if I'm in this state, let's say I get the alphabet 0 and I went to some state, let's say A. And if I were over here and I got the same alphabet 0, and if I went to B, then it says that whatever I learned here is a wrong thing. So what that consistent is trying to say is that if I learned a concept over here, in the top part of the table, if there are two identical rows, when I get some alphabet, I should go to the identical state even in the bottom part of the table. Okay, questions on this? If you have any questions, you might be able to understand by the next few slides because I have lots of examples for this. So let's test your understanding of what we have learned. Is this table closed? Okay, small caveat. I just put this up as random values. Ignore the names of the the rows and columns, because the rows are supposed to be S and columns are supposed to be S.A. Okay, the S part I'll handle. The columns might not be suffix closed. So I just put it up as random values. It's not a truly strictly observation table in our definition sense. But ignore that part, but just look at the table. This thick line separates the top part and the bottom part. Okay, so is this table closed? Why not? Why is it not closed? Sorry, what? Okay, so how do you check if a table is closed? Go back to our analogy. Look at the question paper. What are the questions that are asked in my question paper now? How do you decide that? Row of S. So what is row of A here? 0, 0, 0, 0. Ask yourself the question, is the concept, abstract concept 0000 ever taught to me in class? Was it ever appearing somewhere in the top part of the table? Do we have 0000 in the top part of the table? We don't. Not closed. That's it, right? So any questions on this? Okay. Now I want you to try this out. So I'm really, really bad with PowerPoint slides. I have to like explicitly tell this in advance because, you know, you see, my slides will not have any animation, no flashy colors, nothing at all. I don't believe in animation because, you know, the PowerPoint, I say that, you know, you should not spend too much time making PowerPoint slides because the bullets will kill the audience. So anyway, just look at this. Can you tell me if this table is closed? Why? Okay, forget why. How did you say it's closed? Look at the lower half. Look at all the questions that have appeared over here. Is 00 appearing in the top part of the table somewhere? Yeah, 00 is there. Has 01 appeared somewhere before? Yeah. 00, has it appeared somewhere before? Yeah. So this is closed. Good. What about this? It looks similar, but I made a small modification. Yes. Why? Because 00 has appeared. 01 has appeared. 00 has appeared. But wait. 11. What happened to that? 11. It's not present. The teacher can teach anything she wants in the class. It's not necessary that she should ask every concept that she's taught in the exam. So if a row appears in the top part, it's not guaranteed or necessary that it should appear in the bottom part. You're only looking in the other direction. Everything that appears in the bottom part of the table should have appeared once at least in the top part. Okay? What about this one? Why? 00 is appearing. But what if I tell you that this table is not closed? Because it has no borders. Okay, bad joke. But it's closed. So, okay, now let's move to consistency. Is this table consistent? More difficult to check. To check if a table is closed is straightforward. Look at the bottom part, see if there's an equal thing on the top part. How do you check if a table is consistent? Remember the definition of consistency? You should first of all, what's the very first prerequisite for consistency? The teacher should first of all have suffered from Alzheimer's. That's the first consistency requirement. Teacher should have repeated a concept twice in class. If that thing does not even happen, then it's vacuously true and therefore the table is consistent. So do we have any two rows in the top part of the table which have repeated? No. So this is consistent. Consistency only says this. If there are two rows in the top part of the table which have repeated, then the corresponding lower parts should also have been consistent with each other. But because there is nothing in the top part, then therefore it's trivially true. Right? So, okay, good. What about this one? Checking consistency, as I told, is not easy. How do you check if it's consistent? It is not as easy as checking closeness. Consistent? Okay, so how do you say that a table is consistent? What was your algorithm that you followed? What did you do? How do you say this table is consistent? Okay, so row of lambda and row of ars are identical. So okay, maybe I should go back to the definition. Look at what consistency definition required. Consistency told that if you have these two things equal, row of S1 should be equal to row of S2 in the top part of the table, then for every alphabet A, in this case alphabet is what? A comma B. So take S1 dot A and S2 dot A, then you take S1 dot B and S2 dot B. You should check all those four things. You should see that all those four things also behave consistently. So here the alphabet, as I told, is A comma B. So yeah, okay. In this case, the alphabet is 0 comma. Let's assume binary alphabet here. So alphabet here is 0 comma 1, right? Oh, sorry, wait. I'm sorry. The alphabet is A comma B. This is the observation table. Please excuse me. This 0 comma 1, do not say anything about alphabet. This is only Boolean, yes or no. These are the alphabets, A comma B, fine? So is this, how do you check for consistency? You have got two rows which are identical. What are the two rows which are identical? Lambda and A. So if you have got lambda and A, you must check for row of lambda dot A and then check for row of A dot A. that should be equal to each other. Is that the case? What is rho of lambda dot A? Rho of lambda dot A here is lambda dot A is A, which is, by the way, I don't know how many of you are comfortable with this lambda. I mean, some of you might have been used to using a symbol epsilon. Lambda and epsilon are equal and act as a null string. I prefer to use lambda because Mary had a little lambda. Okay, let me not go down that path. So lambda A is 0, 1. What about AA? Rho of AA. Rho of AA is 0, 0. Are they equal to each other? They're not. So this table is not consistent. Imagine, for example, that let's say this also turned out accidentally to have been 0, 1. Can you say this is consistent now? Not yet, because you also need to check for the other alphabet. Check for rho of lambda dot B and A dot B. Right? So you need to check that. Okay, fine.
What happens if there is rho corresponding to that?
No, rho corresponding to what?
We have A dot B.
Okay.
And we don't have lambda dot
B. That is the reason why I was telling you that how do you construct this table? What did I tell you the bottom part should be? Bottom part should be S dot A. So whatever is there in the top part, you should have already concatenated with A. Do you now appreciate why you need the bottom part of the table? I thank you for asking the question. So the top part of the table consists of all the S prefix for a set of strings. If you did not have the bottom part of the table, S dot A, how would you have checked for consistency? Lambda dot A might not have actually existed in the bottom part of the table at all. That's the reason why I told this S dot A, the bottom part, is just a convenience factor so that for you to look up on the table, it becomes efficient. If you want, you need not actually have had this. But then in that case, for you, checking consistency would have taken an extra step. Because every time you got something like A dot B, you would have to again reconstruct everything. So that's why I'm saying this table is only a convenience factor. Okay. So as you see here, you know, sometimes your asking questions can help understand the concept much better than a long and terse mathematical proof which is given in the paper. Okay. So, what if we say this one was? This is not consistent, right? Fine. Let's look at another example. Okay. So this looks very similar, but for a small change over here. Is this consistent? Very good. So there are no equal rows in the top part of the table, which means it's vacuously consistent, right? So, you know, I'm sure you should all be knowing about this. If you have an implication, an if statement, if A implies B, what does it mean if A is false? What can you say about the implication if A is false? If implication, the antecedent of the implication, if you have A implies B and antecedent A is false, what can you say about the whole implication A implies B? It is true regardless of whatever B takes the value as, either true or false. If A is false, the whole thing becomes vacuously true. For example, if I say the statement like, what should I say? Dragons can fly. Is the statement true or false? Fly or not? It's true, but there are no dragons, right? You can see this as an implication. If there are dragons, it implies they can fly. The antecedent, if there are dragons, is false. But is the whole statement itself false? I'm just saying that if there exist dragons in this world, then they can fly. Yeah, it's a true statement because there are no dragons, but that does not say anything about the implication. So what I'm trying to say is, if the antecedent is false, like it was in this case, then if there are no two equal rows, then the whole implication is vacuously true. Okay, good. So now this is our non-closed table. Is it consistent? Why? Vacuously? No, because there are at least two rows here which are identical. So what should I do now to check for consistency? Which are the two rows which are identical? A and AA, right? So what should I do? I should take A and rho of AA and then what? Concatenated with every letter of the alphabet. You should find rho of AA and find rho of AAA and then find rho of AB and rho of AAB. And then see if these two should be equal to each other and these two should be equal to each other. Is that the case? Is rho of AA? What's rho of AA? 0, 0. What's rho of AAA? 0, 0, 0. So now, do you see why we need the bottom part of the table? If we did not have this AAA, as I was telling earlier, if you did not make the bottom part of the table, you would not be able to answer this question. Okay, what about AB? Rho of AB. Rho of AB is 0, 0. Okay, this, what do we have? This is 0, 0, sorry. So these two are equal. AB is 0, 0. What's AAB? 0, 0. So they're all equal, so you can say the stable is consistent. So now, are you all consistent with the definition of consistent? Okay, very good. So now we'll get back to the algorithm. We told, right, initially we have the table where we assume that S and E are initialized to lambda. I've gone all the way and proved that the world is round. And now I'm coming back to the algorithm. And now we'll see, you have this top part of the table, which is lambda, and then you have bottom part, which is concatenated with this, so you get AB. By the way, how do you fill up this? I had forgotten to mention this. I told you, right, there was this table, initial table, how you construct, you assume S is lambda, assume E is lambda, and then you fill up the table by extending S to S dot A and all of that. What do you fill up in the entries over there? How do you fill that up? Zero. Is this by magic? Very good. So now the way we fill up this table is by asking. The learner is filling up this table. So let's clearly demarcate the roles of the learner and the teacher. The learner is constructing this table, and the learner, in the process of constructing the table, asks queries to the teacher. So while constructing the table, the learner has got this blank thing first, and then the learner wants to fill up this entry for this. So what does the learner do? Ask the teacher the membership query, is lambda dot lambda belonging to the language or not? The teacher says yes. So the learner puts one. Is A dot lambda belonging to the language? A dot lambda. Go. What's our language? Let's remind ourselves of the language. Even number of A's and even number of B's. So is A dot lambda a member of the language? Which means, does A dot lambda have an even number of A's and an even number of B's? No. So therefore you put a zero. Is B dot lambda a member of the language? So read this way. B dot lambda. Concatenate the row with the column. So is B dot lambda a member of the language? It's not, because it does not have even A's and even B's. So you put a zero over there. Okay. So this is our initial first observation table. Notice that we have only got an observation table. We have not got anything more than that. What is our goal? Our ambition in life is to construct the DFA, not to construct stupid observation tables. So this is a very, very complicated algorithm. You first have to learn a lot of definitions before you learn the concept. So how do you get a DFA out of this table? Right now, the learner has only made an observation table. The learner has not yet learned the DFA. Remember that. The learner has only constructed an observation table. From this observation table, there's a mechanical procedure to convert this observation table to a DFA. And this slide explains that. Oh no, this slide does not explain it. I mean, this is the definition of this. In case you have already not known the definition of DFA, you can just quickly look at this. So the DFA corresponds to an observation table. We look at the observation table, which we denote by this SET set or whatever. So SET is the observation table. Corresponding to an observation table SET, there exists a DFA, which we call as MSET. And that DFA has the alphabet of A and states. I'll explain what these are now. So the DFA looks like this. This slide will be important, because eventually when we were constructing the DFA, we need to ask ourselves, what are the rows of the DFA? What are the transitions? Which is the start state? Which is the final state? So this slide is important. What are the states of the DFA? The states of the DFA correspond to, not exactly, just look at that, the notation. This is where mathematical maturity comes into play. I say the set of all rows. Upper half, what do you mean? Okay, fine. For S belong to S. Okay, fine, that's fine. But still, other than that, there's another small thing that you have missed out. This is a set, which means there should be no duplicates. Okay, so that's an important point to note. You will not appreciate it now until we construct the DFA. Just keep this in the back of your mind, okay? So you only look at the upper half. Look at all the unique rows in the upper half, and those unique rows will correspond to the states of the DFA. So the upper half is important. What is the start state? Q0 is the start state. Start state is that corresponding row which corresponds to row of lambda. Whichever is the lambda row in the table, that is the that's the start state of my DFA. The final state is, how do you read this? What's the final state? So the final states are all those states where the row of S should be such that what is that S in this parenthesis you see here? Row of S, I say, right? That S is a string. So you must see that that string actually gets accepted. So the set of all those states, the states in this BFA are all row of s, okay? So this, all those states in this BFA whose value for s, t of s, whose mapping function t evaluates to 1 will be the final state. We will work out this example and you'll see. Transition is perhaps a little complicated. Just see if you can make this out. If not, we'll understand when we're working out the example. What does this say? If I got a row and I got an alphabet, how do I make a transition? So if you look at something like this, AA, remember what did I tell you? That each of these rows are states. So this is a state of my DFA. This is some state of the DFA. How do I fill up the transitions? What's a transition basically? A transition is something that maps a state to another state on an input alphabet. So from this state, if I get an A, where should I go? How do I figure that out? That's what this says. Row of S on an input alphabet A goes to the state. Remember, when I say row, it is actually a state. So you need to use some sort of a laser vision to see that this is actually a state. Don't read this as row. There'll be a lot of rows otherwise. So if you see this as a state, what do you get? This will be a transition. When I'm in this state and I get an A, I transition to which other state? This one, row of AA. So if I get an A, I will go over here. That's what this transition function reads like. So this is all just preliminaries. Now let's actually get on to solving our problem at long last, okay? What did we start off with? We started off with assuming a language that we want to learn, and now we are trying to actually learn the language. Okay, so how did we proceed? We constructed an initial observation table, right? What was our initial observation table we constructed? This one. This was our initial observation table. Every problem for this algorithm starts this way. You start the problem by assuming S and E to be lambda, and then fill up the bottom part of the table, then go and ask membership queries to fill up the entries of the table. Once you're done with that, you have got the table. This is my initial table for the algorithm. Okay, so once you've got this initial table, the next thing that you need to do is this. If you are a human being, you'll not be able to understand this. How many of you are human beings? Okay, well, actually, you know, it gives a person immense sense of power over you, you know, when he puts a mathematical formula and slides like this, because he thinks that, you know, he's so knowledgeable. The reader will think that, you know, everything looks so amazing. He's such a very great person. He must be so knowledgeable. But incidentally, I deliberately put this as a code. I'm a prankster. There's a small typo in this. So you might think that this is correct, but I'm not even going to bother reading over this. I'm just going to skip over this. I don't care about the math. I care about the aftermath. What I'm going to give you is an algorithm for explaining this in terms of only our examples that we have taken. So this is our initial observation table. Let me now explain what the algorithm does. We have got an observation table. What the algorithm now does is, this observation table is under possession of whom? Who has this observation table? Learner. Very good. Learner has this observation table. The learner now checks. The first thing is, the learner checks if this observation table is closed. Why should the learner check that? I hope now you will be able to get the answers after looking at all the previous definitions. If the learner did not check that the observation table was closed, what can go wrong? Look at the transition function. The transition function, I told you what, if I get something like row of A on some symbol A, I'm supposed to go to somewhere else. Imagine a scenario where if I got some AA and input alphabet A, I go to the bottom half of the table and the bottom half of the table is not even a valid row. What does that mean? It means in my corresponding DFA, I'm jumping to some state which does not even exist, right? That's stupid. We don't want that. Therefore, the first thing the learner has to do is check that this observation table is closed. Is this closed or not? Let's revise our definition of closed. Is this closed or not? It is not closed. Why? Because there has been a state here which has not already appeared before. So what the learner now does is to do a correction to make the table closed. So this is the way the learner does it. Why is the table not closed? What's the culprit? Actually, yeah, both of them are culprits. A and B are culprits. Both of them are. But let me rephrase this question. Why did you fail in the exam in this case? Going back to my analogy of exam, why were you not able to answer this question paper? Because my damn teacher did not teach me the concept A. Would it have been so much better for me if the teacher had taught one of these two concepts earlier in class so that I could have learned that in the exam? So how do you correct this? I just told you the answer. Yeah, so I should have the teacher teach me any one of these two concepts earlier in class. So what I do to make this table closed, if a table is not closed, is to move any one of these to the top part of the table. So what do you get as a result of that? What does the top part of the table now become? How many rows are? Okay, lambda and A. What about the bottom part? Wrong. What did I tell you about this? You should, the bottom part is S dot A. What is S? The top part. S dot A should be, for each of this also you should add the suffixes. So AA, AB. You should add this. Now fill up the table. This is lambda. Fill up the table. So what should I put over here? Lambda dot lambda. Is it a member of the language? Does it have even number of A's and even number of B's? Yes. A dot lambda. Is it a member of the language? No. Of language B dot lambda? No. Is this a member of the language? Yes. Is this a member of the language? No. So this is my observation table that I got as a result of converting my non-closed table, open table, to a closed table, even though it has no borders. So now I got a table which is closed. What's the next step? I have to check if this table is consistent. Is this table consistent? Why? Vacuously. Look at the top part. There are no two equal rows, which means this table is consistent. Is this table closed? Yeah, because just 2 seconds ago we made it closed. This table is closed, this table is also consistent. So now what we have got is a valid observation table which is both closed as well as consistent. Now we can construct a DFA out of this. How do you construct a DFA? How do you construct a DFA corresponding to this table? Okay, let's just go back. I don't remember if you remember this. So this is how you construct the DFA. Can you look at this slide and tell me how to construct the DFA corresponding to this observation table? What is the start state? How many states does it have? So okay, how many states does this DFA have? I got an observation table. Remember that every closed and consistent observation table has a corresponding DFA to it. So what is the DFA for this table? How many states does this have? Row of S. So what is S here? Only look at the top part. How many unique rows are there? Two. So they will be the states of the DFA. Okay, so the states, and maybe I mentioned this. Lambda, and this corresponds to row is 1. Row of lambda is 1. This corresponds to A. Row of A is 0. Okay, so these are the two states. Which is the start state? The one which corresponds to row of lambda. So this is my start state. Okay. Now, which is the final state? How do I check the final state? Check which of these row of S, where S, T of that is 1. So I should check for T of lambda and check for T of A. Which of them are 1? It's possible that multiple of them can be 1, right? Why? Because a DFA can have more than one final state. That's perfectly allowed. So is T of lambda equal to 1? How do you check that? Go into the table and check if T of lambda is 1. It is. So this is a final state. Now look at this one. Is T of A 1? It is not. So this is not a final state. So we have got the states, we have got start state, we have got final state. Now the last thing, how about the transitions? How do you fill this up? Alphabet here is A comma B. So let's go to the state and ask ourselves, what happens to this state if I get the input A? How do I figure that out? If I get an A here, what does this state correspond to? The state corresponds to lambda, row of lambda, right? The S here is lambda. So row of lambda here. So if I get an A here, which state should I go to is row of lambda dot A. How do I figure out which is row of lambda dot A? Go to the table here. So row of lambda dot A is A here, or 0. So go to that corresponding state. If I get an A, I go to the state. If I get a B here, where do I go? If I get a B, how do I figure that out? Lambda dot B. Lambda dot B is this one, which corresponds to 0. Don't look at B, because if you said that it goes to B, there is no B state over here in this DFA. That's the reason why we told we are checking for closeness. Because if we did not have closeness, we would have got a new state which we encountered, like a segmentation fault. So therefore, we should look at row of B, which is 0. So it goes to the same state. What happens to this state if I get an A? When I'm in state A and I get an A, I should go to the corresponding state for row of A dot A. What is row of A dot A? 1. Again, let me now repeat the answer I told earlier. Imagine if you did not have the bottom part of the table. You now have to construct this AA one more time. So therefore, this is a convenience factor. So now you can just immediately look up in this table efficiently and see whether this is 1 or 0. So you see, if I'm in state A and I get an A, I should go to row of A, which is 1, which corresponds to this one. So I go here. What happens if I get a B? A dot B is 0, which is this. So I stay here. This is my DFA corresponding to this table. Something went wrong. What is a DFA for even number of A's and even number of B's? It has 4 states. And I told you that was, we all agree that was a minimal DFA. Looks like we have got a much more minimal DFA. Looks like we have a minimal criminal. So, okay, that's a bad poem, but what's wrong here? The point is, this is a learning algorithm. So the learner has started off with an initial hypothesis, learned an original DFA, and now the learner asks the teacher an equivalence query. The learner tells to the teacher, "My dear teacher, I have learned this DFA. Please tell me whether what I have learned is correct or wrong." So now the teacher does what? The teacher should tell false, but it's a very bad teacher if the teacher just says false. Just think of this. If the teacher just tells, "No, what I have learned is wrong," what can the learner do at this point? Learner has no other progress to make. The teacher would be an excellent teacher if the teacher also told the learner, "Why did you go wrong?" In other words, if you have got a wrong answer, the teacher will, in equivalence query, the output you need to change slightly. Output is not just yes or no. The output is yes or no. And in case it is no, teacher should also give a counter example. What do you mean by a counter example? Something that is supposed to belong to the language but does not belong, or vice versa. Something that is not supposed to belong to the language but your language has learned it. So now the learner asks the teacher, "Is this the correct DFA?" Teacher says, "Sorry, dude, you're wrong." But the teacher also says, "Why you are wrong? Why is this wrong? Why is this particular DFA wrong?" Because this DFA also accepts, why do we have a zero here? This is B. Okay, so what's the counter example that the teacher can give? If I get a B, I stay here, that's fine. BA. BA is it valid? It has even A's and even B's? It does not. But this one accepts it. BA or even AB. So, teacher can give any counterexample. We are assuming that we give the minimal length counterexample, okay? So, we can give any counterexample. Teacher gives that. Okay, now let me just run through the slides. So this is the table that we constructed by hand. Because if I just show you the slides first, all of this would have slided above your head. So, I first do it on the board. It's exactly the same thing that we learned. So, now we see that this table is closed and consistent. Out of this, we learned a DFA, which all IEEE papers love to write in this way. They don't love to write this way because this every human being can understand. Okay, so this is the same DFA as is written in form of a transition table. Okay, this is the transition table version of this DFA. You can verify this yourself. I'm a prankster, but you can trust me on this. This is correct. Okay, fine. So now the teacher gives a counter example. We can assume that the counter example is BB. You can assume any counter example. It doesn't matter for the working of the algorithm. Algorithm will still work fine. Imagine that the teacher gives BB as the counter example. Why? Because BB will make this DFA land in this state, which is a non-final state, but the DFA is actually supposed to accept it. Oops, I'm fine. Okay. What did I tell you? I'm really bad at using animations, but you will see me animatedly walking around and falling around everywhere here. Okay, so BB is a counterexample. So what should the learner do with a counterexample? Teacher has told the learner, "Look, my boy, you're wrong. You have learned the DFA wrongly." So now what the learner does is it has to correct itself by adding those new concepts that it has learned into the top part of the table. Add it to the top part because it's a new concept that the teacher has just now taught me, which I want to rectify myself for. So add that to the top part of the table. And is adding to the top part sufficient? Yeah, we need to extend the table because whenever we add BB, the bottom part should also have the suffixes of it, right? So BBA and BBB, and then fill up the holes for this table. So is BB a member of the language? Yeah, because teacher just gave that as answer. Is BBA a member of the language? No. Is BBB a member of the language? It's not. So fine. So this is my new table, my second iteration. Now, what should we do? Now it's just a repetition of what I told earlier, which I'll not repeat myself because a cyclic series of lectures is too much to endure. So what's this? What should we do next? We should check if this table is closed. Check if this is consistent. So is this table closed? Because everything that you have learned here has already been learned, so this is closed. Is this table consistent? Consistency is a little hard to check, right? So you have two equal rows here, A and B. You also have even lambda and BB. You have to check that. So is this consistent? Let's perhaps quickly do that. Why is it not consistent? Oops. I have this terrible habit of falling everywhere I go, you know. Is this table consistent? Why not? Let's look at row of... Okay, you tell me why it's not consistent. I'll just write that. So A and B, row of A is equal to row of B. They're both zero. But row of AA, what's row of AA? Row of A is 1. What's row of BA? BA is 0. Which means I have learned two concepts identically in the class, but in the exam, I've not been able to infer the same things to their extensions, which means this table is not consistent. So earlier in the first iteration, we saw that the table was not closed. What did we do? We made a rectification by adding a new row. Here, if the table is not consistent, we add a new column. Why is this table not consistent? What's the culprit? What made this table not consistent? This extra A, right? This extra A itself made the table inconsistent. If I got A and B identical, appending this alphabet A made it inconsistent. It's the alphabet A here that was the culprit. So we add the new column for A. Add one more column for A and then fill up the table in the same way. So now here, lambda dot A, you need to fill up the table. A dot A you need to fill up and B dot A and so on. So now is this table closed? Is this table consistent? That's all algorithm is. No more to the algorithm. All of you must agree this is magic. How on earth does this work? But yeah, maybe let's just run through this and just see. Is this table closed? Is this consistent?
How can it ever be? Because already the first digit is this place, that is 1 and 0 are different.
No, but... No. You see, even though the first thing is misplaced, when I add AA, that is where the difference arises. Observe this. Now, what am I looking? I'm looking at the row. I'm not looking at A. I'm looking at row of A and row of AA, which means row of A is not 0 anymore. Row of A is 0, 1. Row of AA is 1, 0. So, in this case, however, are there any two identical rows in the top part? Earlier, what were the two identical rows? Identical rows earlier were A and B, which means earlier in the first iteration, you thought that states A and state B were identical, indistinguishable from each other. But this counter example, this is the reason why you added one more column. This told you that your original assumption of A and B being identical states was wrong. A and B are no longer identical states. They can be distinguished. However, there are these other two identical states. Lambda and BB. Row of lambda is 1, 0. Row of BB is 1, 0. So is this table consistent now? Why? Because lambda dot A is A, which is 0, 1. BB dot A is also 0, 1. Lambda dot B is 0, 0. BB dot B is also 0, 0. So this table is consistent. Is this closed? 0, 0 is there. 1, 0 is there. 0, 1 is there. 0, 0 is there. Is a closed table. So now can you construct the DFA corresponding to this? What's the DFA corresponding? Notice, important point, you can construct a DFA only if the table is closed and consistent. If either one of them is not, you can't make a DFA out of it. So now can you construct the DFA for this? What's the DFA corresponding to this table? What are the states? How many states does it have? 4 states? If you told the answer 4, you should be crucified. What did I tell you? Set. Set of all unique rows of the top part. How many unique rows are there? 1, 0 has already repeated in the top part. 1, 0 has appeared twice. That's why I told the bracket notation says the set of all row of S. How many row of S are there? There are actually only 3. There's 1, 0, which corresponds to lambda. There is what else? For A, it's 0, 1. Then for B, it is 0, 0. So these are the 3 states of my DFA. Okay. Which is the start state? The one which corresponds to lambda, which I've already marked. What about final state? How do you find the final state? Whichever of these has a t function equal to 1. Is t of lambda equal to 1? How do you check that? Go to this table, look at the lambda row and lambda column. Is t of lambda equal to 1? It is. So this is the final state. is P of A equal to 1? How do you check if T of A is 1? Look at A dot lambda. Or you can even look at lambda dot A. Lambda dot A is also the same, right? So that's 0, so it's not a final state. What about B? Is that a final state? Is T of B equal to 1? T of B, how do you get T of B? T of B dot lambda is equal to T of B. So also T of lambda dot B, but you don't have a B column. So this is not a final state. What about transitions? What happens here if you get an A? If I get an A from this state, what is the meaning of that? I am in rho lambda. If I get an A, I'm supposed to go to rho of lambda dot A. Rho of lambda dot A is, in this case, is 0, 1. So if I get an A here, I go to the state. If I get a B, I should go to lambda dot B, which is that state. Okay, this one is filled up. What about this? If I get an A, AA, I should go to rho of AA. We don't have AA over here. Therefore, we should look at rho. Rho of AA is 1, 0, which is this one. So if I get an A, I go here. What happens if I get a B? When I'm in the state, I should go to rho of AB. Rho of AB is 0, 0, which is that one. Okay. What happens to this state if I get an A? I should go to rho of BA. BA is 0, 0, which is itself. I loop. What happens if I get a B? I should go to rho of BB, which is 1, 0, which is this state. Okay. So I have constructed a DFA corresponding to this particular observation table. What's the next step? I ask the teacher and I tell the teacher, look, teacher, I learned this DFA. Am I right or not? I'm not right. So this is all the algorithm is. The teacher says this is not okay. So if the teacher says it's not okay, teacher gives a counterexample. So I'll just quickly run through this. Let's assume in this case counterexample is A, B, B. So what happens now? What should I do? I should add the counterexample to the top part of the table because I'm learning that from the teacher as part of training data. And therefore I extend the table for A, B, B to its suffixes. I've got this new table filling up the blanks. And then I should check if this table is closed and consistent. Is this closed? It looks a very, very messy table, right? But I think this is probably closed. 0, 0 is present. 1, 0 is there. 0, 1 is there. 1, 1 is need not be there. Fine. So this is closed. Is this consistent? It's not consistent. Why? Because yeah, we have got three states. If this says it's consistent, then something's wrong. So it's definitely not consistent. But maybe I'll not run through that because we don't have time. But it's definitely not consistent for one reason. One of the two equal rows. Are there multiple equal rows? Yeah. 1, 0 is there. There's also 0, 1 repeater, 0, 0. We have three things to check. I'll not check it now because time is more important. So okay. So in this case, the culprit was the alphabet B. Some row, assume I don't know which. Let's imagine that the row which caused the trouble was this 1, 0 pair. 1, 0, let's imagine lambda and BB. Let's imagine that it caused a trouble when it was concatenated with B, which means lambda dot B went to something, whereas BB dot B went to something else. In this case, they actually go not to the same thing. So okay, that's not the same thing. You can work it out and verify. But imagine that that was the culprit. So we add that other extra column because of which now this table will be consistent. And corresponding to this, you can make the corresponding DFA. How many states does this have? How many unique rows are there here? 1, 0, 0 is 1. 0, 1, 0 is the second. 0, 0, 1 is the third. 0, 0, 0 is the fourth. So there are four states. And if you fill up this table, you get the transition table. You get exactly the same DFA. So this is all the algorithm is all about. So any questions on this? Except for the question on how it works. Because you need to read the paper to actually know why it works. It's a beautifully long mathematical proof by induction as to why it works. It's a magic algorithm, okay? So okay, this is the DFA. Now you can read this algorithm and now you can make. Incidentally, I played a prank on you. The previous slide was exactly correct. I did not make any typo. It's the same slide that I repeated over here. So now you can read this and say whether the algorithm that I explained to you orally is what is written in the paper. So this is what it says. Initialize SNE to empty set. Then ask membership queries. Okay. Then construct the initial observation table that we did as before. And then check if the table is closed and consistent. If it is not consistent, this is a long, complicated mathematical form of saying whatever I said earlier in plain simple English, which was you find the culprit column and then add that to E, which is the columns, add a new column and then extend the table by filling up the holes in the table. If it is not closed, find the culprit row and add that to S and then extend it using membership queries. And then finally, once this is done, you get a M set. Remember what M set was? M set was the DFA corresponding to SET. You get a DFA and then ask the equivalence query to the teacher. If the teacher says the answer is no, the teacher will give a counter example T. Then you need to add T and its prefixes, which I forgot to mention. Remember that S is supposed to be prefix clause. So if the teacher gives a counter example, you cannot just blindly add it to S, because you also need to ensure it's also prefix clause. So you need to, that we did not do because it so happened coincidentally, my examples were very nice, but you need to also look at its prefixes and add that to S, and then extend this and keep on repeating this until the teacher gives S. Answer is yes. Questions about this? Any doubts? Okay, so I think I've taken up too much time. So
is trap state also obtained with this?
Yeah, method? Yes. It's a minimal DFA that you learn out of this. So it will also learn the trap state. So I want you to try this out at home as a homework. Okay, so apply the Langlands algorithm on this, and you know, you actually know how to get the actual answer for this. So you can imagine that you yourself are the teacher because you know the answer. You need to suffer from split personality here. Imagine you're also the teacher and the learner. You can actually learn the DFA for this. Okay. Any questions? And as I told, I am a prankster because this is still not the end. Okay, so how could I say this is the end if I am not even giving you the reference of the paper? Otherwise, you will not even let me out of the room. I am putting so much suspense, telling you you need to go to the paper, and I didn't even tell you what was the paper. Now it's actually the end. Okay, you can leave. I'm done for the day. Okay, so you can go out for a break. Is there any announcement?